Father, we reflect the glory of God. We strive to be holy people. We strive to be on us in today's service, and that all things that are done today will be done to your name's honor and glory, as we seek to fear you, as we seek to rejoice before you, as we seek to come together as a family. We bless your name. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. Well, greetings again, everyone. Welcome, 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 one and all, to the great feast of Tabernacles. I see quite a few more persons than were here last night for the opening service are here this morning. So I want to greet those who I have not had the opportunity to greet as yet, and welcome you here to our feast site in Runaway Bay with the Church of God International Jamaica. Now, last night we started with a rousing opening night service, and I must say that I am filled with a spirit of expectation for this feast. As I was saying last night, it's probably one of my most anticipated feasts, because for several months there was a lot of uncertainty, not about whether or not we'd keep the feast. We knew for sure, according to God's word, that we would keep his feast, in terms of how exactly we would do so. But it is finally here. All the uncertainty has passed, and we are gathered together in the name of the Lord in obedience to his commandments to worship and to rejoice before him. Amen. I also want to send greetings to our online viewers, you know, those who are not here, those who are watching us from across the world. You know, we have had a lot of company, a lot of visitors from overseas through YouTube, Facebook, who have been following us over the past few months. So I want to also specially greet you who are not here physically with us, but here with us in spirit and in truth. I also want to greet my family, my immediate family. My father and my mother are here. Please give them a warm welcome. You know, they were here at the feast about 3 years ago in 2017, and they are back here today. And my sister is here with them as well as her two children, my nephew and my newest niece, just a few months old. Hi, Hannah. I also want to greet Pastor Ramakan, and well, I don't see Sister Lola, but I imagine she's somewhere here, so I greet Pastor Ramakan. Thank you, Pastor, for joining us all the way from the United Kingdom here at the feast in Jamaica. And we have been here for over 2 weeks, you know, waiting out your quarantine period, and finally you are here with us, and we are happy, Pastor, to have you here in the congregation with us. And the light from here, it really prevents me from seeing what's going on down there, so I'm not seeing anything at all but shadows in front of me, so I can't tell if Pastor Hall is here as yet. But let's... Oh, there he is, yes. So welcome, Pastor Hall, and whoever would have joined him here. I know that he has a message to deliver at the nearby feast site, so we won't detain him much longer. He's here for a special invitation, a special purpose, and for this, I will invite Pastor Ramakan to come at this time to go through or to lead this important ceremony. So, Pastor Ramakan, I invite you at this time to to take the stage here. You can use the one on this side.
Good morning, brethren. I am extremely, extremely happy to be here with you for the Feast of Tabernacles over the next 8 days. But we have paused at this point in the service for a very special occasion. Brethren, over the past 2 years, I have been working with two very diligent, exemplary men who have faithfully followed the Word of God in seeking to serve the church and the brethren, particularly in the Kingston congregation. And these are men who, out of that training and the many other interactions, we are confident that they have met the qualifications for eldership in the Church of God. I speak of Deacon Christopher Hendricks, and I speak of Deacon Stephen Scale. The Apostle Paul, in his instructions to Titus, in Titus 1, verses 5 to 9, says, "The reason I left you in Crete was that you might put in order what was left unfinished and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. An elder must be blameless, faithful to his wife, a man whose children believe and are not open to the charge of being wild and disobedient. Since an overseer, which is another phrase for an elder, manages God's whole household, he must be blameless, not overbearing, but quick and not quick-tempered, not given to drunkenness, nor violent, nor pursuing dishonest gain. Rather, he must be hospitable, one who loves the word of God. He must be firmly and hold firmly to what has been taught. He has been taught so that he can encourage others by sound doctrine and refute those who oppose sound doctrine." Brothers and sisters, these two men have labored faithfully and well in the Lord's harvest. And in doing so, neither of them sought after their own interest, but indeed after the interest of God's work and of others. Indeed, I stand here today to say they exemplify the words of Jesus in Matthew 23, verse 12. Jesus said, "For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who are humble will be exalted." I would like at this point to invite Pastor Pedro Hall to join me on the platform for conducting this ordination. And may I invite at this time Brother Chris Hendricks, along with his wife Eulalie, to the platform. May I ask the congregation to stand. Just because of the COVID thing, we're going to stand, sort of. Oh, you'd like for us to come there? Oh, so you can see. Yes, I'm sorry about that. Could we go a little further up where we can? Let us pray. No, place your hand on the next. O God and Father of all mankind, the chief shepherd of your church, who have appointed men throughout the ages to become shepherds of your flock, we thank you that by your Holy Spirit, you have called this man, Christopher Hendricks, to serve in your church, Heavenly Father, to be able to provide for your flock, to lead, to feed, to protect the people of God. We thank you for his wife, Eulalie, who is kneeling by his side, who is so essential to the success of the ministry which you have given to him. And so, Father, upon the authority of your word, we now lay hand upon him and ask you that by your Holy Spirit, you will give him the wisdom, the humility, the patience, the understanding, the spirit of forbearance, and all the qualities, Heavenly Father, that your spirit provide to your ministers. We realize that the times ahead are rough, that there will be more and more storms and difficulties that your church will encounter. And we need men, Heavenly Father, appointed by you to do the work of an elder. And so, Heavenly Father, at this time, we ask you that you'll exercise your authority in appointing him as an elder to the eldership of the church to carry out your work. We pray, we ask these things in no other name but the almighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who is chief shepherd of the church, and on whose behalf we work until he comes. Bless us now, we pray, in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Thank you. You may stand. And I'll just ask you to stand, to remain on the platform and to stand over here. And I would like to, at this point, to invite Deacon Stephen Scale and his wife, Mishka, to the platform. And I'll ask Pastor Hall to pray. Hold hands, please.
Great eternal Father, we come before your awesome presence. We lift you up and we magnify your great name. You are indeed God and God alone, and great is your faithfulness. We thank you, God, for this great opportunity to be here at the Feast of Tabernacles. We thank you for your love and your grace towards us. Indeed, God, you are mighty God, and we thank you and we hail you, the great I am. Father, we come before your presence in this very special occasion. Father, as we place before you Brother Stephen Scale, who you have appointed, who you have selected to work in your ministry, to work in your body, to feed your flock for you. We thank you, God, that he has been trained and he has displayed the qualities and the virtues of an elder. We thank you, God, for his wife, Mishka, who walks beside him and has been to him a help meet. Father, as we, your anointed elders, have placed our hands on him, we ask, Almighty God, that your Holy Spirit may gift him now with all the qualities and all the virtues and all that is needed for him to lead your people. Father, we are cognizant of the fact that the body belongs to you and not to us, and that you have put us in charge, and we are accountable to you. And so we pray, great God, that he will remember this every day as he leads your people, despite the challenges and despite the hiccups and whatever may come, Lord, as he leads, that he remember that he is doing this on your behalf. And so we pray right now, God, that you anoint him. We pray, God, from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. We pray, God, that your anointing will flow through him and that he be empowered, God, not by might, not by his own power, but by your spirit. Hallelujah. 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 And we pray, great God, that you may use him as you have never used him before, and that your flock, your sheep, may look to him as you lead them to you. Father, we just thank you. We pray, God, that you continue to be with his wife, and that she will stand by his side always, and that she'll support him in whatever he does. Father, we know that this where this responsibility is very taxing, and it can affect even family and marriage if it's not properly done. And so we pray, God, that you will help her to support him in the best way possible. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you again, and we pray, great God, that you now as we lay our hands on him, that you will now place your hand and that you appoint him an elder in the Church of God International. We thank you and say thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Please remain. You can stand. Let me just, we have, I just want to ensure we are going through with the various. At this point, brethren, we have credentials to be presented to these gentlemen. And Pastor Hall, I would ask you whether you could just read, and I'll present the credentials at this point. Yes. You do once for Chris and once for.
Thank you much.
Members of the Church of God International, be it known by the presentation of this official document that Christopher Hendricks has been approved by the Board of Trustees of the Church and that he has been officially ordained on this, the third day of October, in the year 2020, as a minister of Jesus Christ, and that by this document that he received momentarily, he is authorized to perform all the duties of the clergy. And this document is signed by Chairman of the Board of Van Stinson, Chairman of the Ministerial Council, Mike Nolan, and Secretary of the Board, George Crowe. Thank you. Member of the Church of God International, be it known by the presentation of this official document that Stephen Scale has been approved by the Board of Trustees of the Church and that he has been officially ordained on this, the third day of October in the year 2020, as a minister of Jesus Christ, and that by this document, which will be presented to him momentarily, is authorized to perform all the duties of the clergy. Signed, Chairman of the Board, Vance Stinson, Chairman of the Ministerial Council, Mike Nolan, and Secretary of the Board, George Crowe.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor and my pleasure, after years of hard work, dedicated service of these men to your congregation and indeed to the wider Church of God International in Jamaica, to present to you your elders, your two new elders here in the congregation, and their wives. Elder Christopher Hendricks and Elder Stephen Scale.
To just join
Just want to take the opportunity to share my gratitude to you, my brothers and sisters who have supported and encouraged me over the years and through this journey. It would certainly not have been possible without your support, without your encouragement, your prayers, most importantly, to be in this position where I can serve you and continue to serve you, as has been my heart desire over the years. So thank you all very much. Before we go into the rest of our program, I want to invite Deacon, well, no, Elder. We're going to have to get used to it. Elder Christopher Hendricks to share with us some of the protocols while we are here at the Feast of Tabernacles that we should bear in mind and observe over the 8 days that we are here. So, Elder Christopher Hendricks, please come at this time.
Thank you very much, Elder Scale. I'm extremely proud of you. As a young man, I thought you had great potential, and you have certainly been fulfilling that and been growing from strength to strength. Let me just take the opportunity to thank both Pastors Hall and Ramakan, not only for performing the ceremony, but the role that they played in mentoring myself and Elder Scale throughout the program and even before that. I want to thank every one of you who have supported us and given us encouragement throughout difficult times and so on. As the ceremony was taking place, I could not help but my mind cast back to Pastor Ian Boyne, and when I think of him, I get a bit emotional because of the work that he has done with all of us throughout the years, and it's just a pity that he weren't here to see this part of his work come to fruition. Nonetheless, it is our charge to take up the baton and to move it further until others take their turn as well. I welcome everyone to the feast here. Very happy to have you all out. And I can see by your spirit and enthusiasm that you're looking forward to 8 great days together, as are we all. There are a few things that we need to bear in mind for us to have a successful feast, the cornerstone of which is love and consideration for each other. The protocols because of the COVID is well known, the distancing and so on. We will be observing that. We will try as much to be spaced as to that there are still some rooms here so that we can utilize. Please try and leave the seats as they are arranged so that we don't have any issue coming up. Now, there are some persons here who have journeyed in faith because they have what are called comorbidities. They have underlying conditions. We have to be careful and mindful of everyone. Some persons are here at greater risk than others. So, it is important that we respect each other's space. Now, because of what has happened, there are some persons who may be very cautious. It is not because they are antisocial, so we need to take that into consideration. Some persons might, out of abundance of caution, might not want to be hugged, for instance. Do not try to enforce that on anyone, and please, please, please do not hold it against anyone. There are some of us who are traveling from places far and wide where the virus has taken root in greater numbers than in certain places. Out of abundance of caution, some persons, out of wanting to protect themselves and others, might not be as warm as they would normally be. This is not to be taken as a slight. We see how dangerous it is, even among the skeptics, such as the President of the United States, it has now affected. Therefore, it can strike at any time and can strike anyone. Please bear in mind, the cornerstone of our interactions with each other is love and consideration. We are proclaiming a world to come in which the interests of others takes precedence over our own. Love is an action word, not an emoji. Therefore, let us have this love on display in the way that we interact with each other. Remember the protocols. I believe that if we do this, we will go a long way in ensuring that despite all of the challenges, we can still have the best feast ever. The greatest ingredient for the best feast ever is what I commend to you, love and consideration. Thank you.
I thank you very much, Deacon Hendricks. I tell you, you're creatures of habit. Elder Hendricks. Right, just to let you know that, of course, the wearing of face masks, as we have said on many occasions, is required. If you happen to have left your mask, you forgot it, then in that case of emergency, we do have a spare mask, a few, in case anyone comes to the service and would have left their mask. So if you are one such person, then please find Deacon Grant. He should be able to give you a mask for the day, for today. All right, so if you don't have a mask, then get one from Deacon Grant. Right, before we hear the main message for today, we do have a few special items. The first will come to us from Sister Mary White with a poem. She'll be followed by Sister Margaret Boyne. So Sister Mary, please welcome her as she comes with this special item.
Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath. No one has sounds so happy yet. Happy Sabbath. No, we're talking. As true Jamaicans, out of many one language, we have created many. And one such is the patois. Today, we have Dolores representing the Queen's English, and you have Moa representing the Jamaican patois. So welcome, boys and girls. Welcome, ladies and gents. Welcome all to Feast of Tabernacles 2020. Reset your spirit to have some fun and enjoy the sun, because we're here. Work is done. Are you ready? Come, let's run it. Go, Dolores.
It's time to stop and enter into Yahweh's rest. It's time to remember we are too blessed to be stressed. It's time to don your Sabbath best. It's time to spread some good cheer with the rest. It's time to meditate on His goodness and not your test.
There's a time and place to everything under the sun. All right, about now, it's Tabernacles time. So let's see all of them. Lele, sad, penke, thank you, greedy, won't give me. Need to stop right now. When you pay the money, come here, good up money, right? When you really go back on the yard and have some fun, come on, boys and girls. If I was God, I'd be mad.
Recharge and rejoice. Plug out of Babylon and plug into Zion. It's your choice. Decide to power down. Shut out the noise to feel His energy. Raise a praise, lift your voice. Yes, you can. You are wonderfully created. You are a smart device.
Nobody make one of them man-made sin thing that make we look bad. We're supposed to be smarter than them. There's something that we are human. So if them knows their time, sometime them have a lockdown to recharge, what about us? We no must know that too. Come on. Why we are galang so like we fool? Like we are robot till we run we self to a wreck, but not the Tabernacles.
Until that great day in New Jerusalem, wear your salvation like an emblem. While we live in Babylon, a modern day Harlem, never forget we have dominion, not them.
Mama used to say before no dancer yard enough, before no dancer broad enough, you dance a yard, right? How we are going to walk, talk, skip and jump in a New Jerusalem if we can't take charge? No, in a we look a problem. How we are going to rule in the millennium? Come boys and girls, who are the man a yard? Who is in charge?
Pop your collar, square your shoulders. You are royalty. As feast-keeping people, we are dignitary. Yahweh's bestowed blessings, grace, and mercy to remember his Sabbaths and keep them holy. Mission evangelism, share your story.
Only better no say, we are God picking you. Only royal blood flow through this year, buddy. Don't go on like on the Mount Zion Church. Una make it make for nyam, chat and tell people, say God really good for you.
Recharge and rejoice, we made it. Recharge and rejoice, we are celebrating Tabernacles 2020. Recharge and rejoice, we have kept the faith. Recharge and rejoice, we are still in the race. Recharge and rejoice. Let's give thanks and praise.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. We die. We still in the race, hallelujah. Yeah, man. We are make it, we make it to another feast.
Ready?
Wait for it. May the blessings of,
favor of Yahweh,
who has separated the ordinary from the holy, chosen us for his glory, causes us to feel special and happy, and inspires us to behave like
royalty. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everybody. Revelation 2020, written by Mark, me. A man looked on with pride at all his success. The technology he brought us, the road to progress. Diseases eradicated, genetic code unlocked. The human genome successfully mapped. Artificial intelligence, robotics, the future. Gender reassignment, defying nature. Manipulating man's DNA, iron out the kinks. 5G technology and the Internet of Things. Tesla, SpaceX, soon you'll travel to Mars. Microchip implants, self-driving cars. And the world looked on and said, isn't this great? Man being like God can create, replicate. Swapped religion for spirituality, and experience became greater. Locked the doors of the churches as the world became secular. Values changed, now a pursuit of happiness. No time, a busy emptiness. Traded Yahweh for other counterfeit gods. Money, possessions, fame, celebrities, and fads. put God in a box at the back of the shelf, and in front, put plaques, awards, and pictures of self. Just when man thought he had the solutions and plans, an enemy invaded as the world looked on. The world held in limbo by a cough or a sneeze, a virus so small that we all cannot see. Exposing normalcy as only a myth reminds us of our mortality, our fragile lives at risk. Self-isolation, stay-at-home orders, curfew, when God was just saying, be still and know. Press all reset buttons, time for reflection. Take away our idols, recapture our attention. And man looked on at the work of his hands as it came tumbling down as it was built upon sands. Stock market plummets, global meltdown, unemployment, hysteria, the future unknown. And the world is locked in prisons called homes, scenes of death, confusion as the death toll mounts. Streets become empty as the world stands still, wondering, where's God? We need to find him. So he searched and found him where he left him to be. He dusted him off and fell on his knees. As frontline responders, let's not hover in fear. This is a wake-up call. Be alert, be prepared. Teach our children to be resilient, how to be strong, not to invest their whole lives on a temporary one. Tomorrow's not promised. Nothing in life is guaranteed. In an unpredictable world, man's failure revealed. A revelation that man cannot direct his own steps. A revelation of what truly matters in life, lest we forget. We need the gospel of the kingdom, God's master plan. It is only the Almighty who holds the world in his hands.
I thank those who have brought our special item so far, Sister Mary, Sister Dolores, and Sister Boyne, sharing that original poem or final special item for this still morning, and will come to us in the form of a dance, a solo. So I'll invite the soloists to come with that dance for the final special item. Please welcome them.
Oh,
Items this morning. We truly appreciate the work and the service that you have rendered for us today. Now, just a few other housekeeping matters. Some of you may be wondering where the restrooms are. So we have many restrooms, but the easiest one to direct you to is the one on my left. As you go outside into that huge open area, then head towards the left, and then there's a sharp turn at the corner there. There are restrooms there that you can avail yourself if you need to. As well, bear in mind that this is an all-inclusive premises hotel. We have been given permission to use the hall and the restroom and those lobby areas, especially if you're not staying here. Please do not venture anywhere outside of the immediate hall here, outside there, and the restrooms. All right, so that is what we have been given permission to use. So don't go just checking out the premises because you're here, if you're not staying here. So please remember that. And parents, well, all of us need to look out for the children as well, who are very adventurous and would want to run around. Please remind them and keep an eye on the children. It's that time where we will join together. We'll sing songs of praise to Almighty Lord and Savior. So I'll invite the praise team to come at this time. Before we hear from our main speaker, we'll have a few praise and worship items. So praise team, you're up.
Good morning. Happy first day. Happy Sabbath. Hallelujah. We're here to rejoice. So, some of you may know this song, our Feast of Tabernacles theme song. So just stretch, relax, rejoice.
Feast of Tabernacles,
Feast of Tabernacles,
praises
to the King.
Feast of Tabernacles,
all the earth rejoice.
Feast of Tabernacles,
has lift your voice.
Feast of Tabernacles,
ever no more sin.
We're gonna walk, talk, sing and shout. We're gonna walk, talk, sing and shout.
In Jerusalem,
walk, talk, sing and shout. We're gonna walk, talk, sing and shout.
In Jerusalem,
spread the sing and shout. We're gonna walk, talk, sing and shout. Walk, talk, sing and shout. We're gonna walk, talk, sing and shout.
We're gonna spread the love.
Feast of Tabernacles,
all the earth rejoice.
Feast of Tabernacles,
lift your hand, raise your voice.
Feast of Tabernacles,
no more devil, no more sin.
Feast of Tabernacles,
shout praises to the King.
Feast of Tabernacles, all the earth rejoice.
Come on, rejoice.
Feast of Tabernacles,
raise your hands and raise your voice.
Feast of Tabernacles,
no more devil, no more sin.
Feast of Tabernacles,
shout praises to the King. Shout praises to the King. Show praises to the King! Hallelujah! Woo. All right, so now that we've warmed up, we're going to sing, Lord, you are good, and your mercies endureth. Just for a short time? Forever? Say forever!
Forever!
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Thank you, Lord.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever.
One more time.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth.
praising Him, thanking Him. We are here at the Feast of Tabernacles to rejoice. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to Him a new song.
I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to Him a new song. I will praise Him. I will sing to Him a new song. I will praise Him. I will sing to Him a new song.
I will
celebrate. Rejoice in the Lord always and again. Hallelujah. Tell him I'm going to ask you just to raise. Rejoice for me. Woo! Come on, put your hands together.
The Lord always.
Yeah.
And again I say, again I say, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, again I say, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, again I say, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, again I say, rejoice.
Hallelujah to all.
be praises to our God.
Sing glory.
Sing hallelujah to our God.
Glory, hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah. It's to our God. Every praise, it's to our God. God, my Savior. God, my healer. God, my deliverer. Yes, He is. Yes, He is. God, my Savior.
God. Hallelujah. Woo! Yes. We're going to let the Lord know we are so thankful. We are gathered together. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to sing this. We're going to slow it down now. And we're going to sing, "We place you at the highest place." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We place you at the highest place because He's what? The great high priest.
Amen.
Amen.
We place you at the highest place, for you are the great high priest. We place you high above all else.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Every moment, have your way in me.
There is a sweet
every moment
anointing in the sanctuary.
Oh yes,
there is a steam.
Hallelujah, there's a sweet
in the atmosphere.
Hallelujah.
Come and lay down the burden.
Here to rejoice, amen? And that's what we are going to do in the presence of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We will rejoice with all our heart, with all our soul, with everything within us. We will bless His holy name, amen. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready to hear the word that God has prepared for us? Well, let me just invite you to stand. I'm just getting you to be even more ready. You've been sitting for a while. Just stand to your feet, everyone. Get up, 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 up. All right, let the blood flow. Stretch if you can, stretch. Oh, yes. All right. Pastor Ramakan, they are now truly ready. So at this time, you may be seated as I welcome for today's the first message, the first sermon for this great Feast of Tabernacles 2020. Please join me in welcoming Pastor George Ramakan.
Thank you very much, Elder Scale. And brethren, I'm extremely excited to be here today to join you at the Feast of Tabernacles. I certainly want to extend a warm welcome to all the persons who have come here from far distances, and particularly to those who are here for the first time. it means a lot to us that you have come. And it is our intention over the next 8 days to amplify the Word of God in such a manner that you will hear it in a different way than you have for many, many years. We know you have come here against the background of a pandemic. We know that you and your family have been in some way affected by it. There's nobody that is not affected by this pandemic. And so I commend you for the enormous sacrifice you have made to be here. There are so many that they have lost their jobs, that they have in some way become economically poorer than they were before the pandemic. The issue of family and school has become a big issue. Your children have not been in school for maybe 6 months now. And there's so much confusion, there's so much quandary. People are just wondering what to do and what next. Up to 3 weeks ago, it was not clear to us that we would have been able to meet face to face like this for the 8 days. We were looking at alternatives if we were not complying with the rules of the government under which we live, to meet on the first and the last day and then to do some kind of virtual meeting in between. But you know what? We went on fasting. We knelt down before God in prayer because we know that ultimately there is an enemy with power who seeks to plunder and to destroy. And there is no man-made system that can fight that enemy. There's only one source of power that could override it. And we thank God today that we are the victors because we can meet like this. And I want to thank the team of persons who have all cooperated and pulled together to make this happen. In particular, I want to recognize Brother Grant and Brother Clark for the work that they did, some due diligence. As we meet, I know it's a bit warm. It's very warm on the outside. And the hotel has told us that they are looking at the air conditioning to see whether it can be come a little cooler for us. So I ask you to bear with us as we all try to live through this, the challenges. I mean, this is all the challenge that we have. We have none. So let's use it. You'll see that I was wearing a very dark glass earlier, and that is because I am actually recovering from an eye operation. And I can't take too much glare in my eyes for that reason. And so I rested it so that I could wear a little clearer glass now, so that I could see you a little bit better, and also to see my notes a little bit better. The Feast of Tabernacles is a time of rejoicing. We all know that. But Satan is not happy with feast goers, because we just came out of a torment. And we warned him. We told him that your days are numbered. And there is a power in the earth. And that power is the work of God through the church of God that is spreading the gospel. And through which God is calling those who will reign with him as kings and priests. But Satan strikes, you know. You may think that, well, why me? Why do these things happen? Satan strikes at any and everyone who stands up for righteousness. And Jesus himself was struck by problems as the feast approached. In John 7, we see Jesus having a struggle with his brothers, who had very little regard for his authority. His own household turned against him, even though they too go to the feast. That's the awkward thing. That's how Satan rules and divides. He rules and divides in very subtle ways. And if you turn with me and we begin in verse 2 of John 7, it says, "Now the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was at hand. Jesus' brothers therefore said to him, 'Depart from here and go to Judea, that your disciples also may see the works that you are doing.'" Now that was a very unfriendly thing to say to him. Why? If you look at verse 1, we started in verse 2. But if you look at verse 1, it tells you that Jesus stayed away from Judea because they sought him out to kill him. And he didn't want to be within reach of the enemy. And Jesus replied to them. Well, they continued in verse 4. They say, "Go to Judea, for no one does anything in secret while he himself seeks to be known openly." It's a kind of a ridicule. He was being ridiculed. "If you do these things, show yourself to the world." Those were kind of very arguments of very high disregard for him. And why were they saying these things to him? Verse 5 explains, "For even his brothers did not believe in him." Imagine Jesus. Imagine, born of the same mother. And you would think that if there's anybody who believed in him and knew him, it would be those of his household. But somehow, Satan was able to plant a wedge. They did not understand his circumstances, that he was really struggling against those who were seeking to kill him. They did not know his mission, why he was here, and what he was called on to do. They sound almost like Joseph's brothers, who sought to get rid of him when it was God who was carrying out his work
in Joseph. So they were just locked up in their own narrow view of the world. Verse 6. Then Jesus said to them, "My time has not yet come, but your time is always ready. The world cannot hate you, but it hates me, because I testify of it that its works are evil." Sometimes we are too friendly with the world. Sometimes the world falls in love with us because we are very accommodating of the ways of the world. So even though his brothers were his keepers, the world did not hate them because they saw feast as a ritual. They were not seeing it in the light that Jesus was seeing it. Despite all this, Jesus encouraged them to go to the feast. Even though he was being ridiculed, even though they would have preferred to see him out of the way, he encouraged them to go to the feast. He said, "You go to this feast." That in itself, individuals who say, "This is an Old Testament thing that is not for Christians," need to look at this again and to understand that it constitutes a command. "I am not yet going." Some read it to say he said he's not going. But he said, "I'm not yet going up to this feast, for my time has not yet fully come." He was speaking about the time when he would have been caught by the enemy and would have been put to death. When he had said these things to them, he remained in Galilee. And Jesus nonetheless, against the odds of him being killed, "You're looking at making sacrifices to come to the feast? You're looking at the things you have to put up with in order to make it to the feast?" Jesus nonetheless went to the feast secretly, even though a death threat was upon his life. Verse 10. "But when his brothers had gone up, then he also went up to the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret." I don't know if he sort of covered himself or how he disguised himself, but he went up, not openly, but secretly. "Then the Jews sought him at the feast and said, 'Where is he?'" What do you get from that? It is telling you that they knew that if there was one place that they can find Jesus, it is at the feast. That is where you are sure. "I can't find him. I'm looking for him. I'm trying to scout him out. But I know where to find him. Wait until feast time. We are going to find him there." Because Jesus was a feast goer. How many persons can say that of you and me? That, you know, it's a long time I don't see that man, but I know where to find him. I know when to look for him. Because I know he's not missing that. He's not missing that. So they expected to see him at the feast. He was a regular feast goer. And no matter how much he's hiding or whatever, they know they will get him. The lesson to take away from this is, if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, no matter the circumstance, you have to be at the feast. Yes, I know, there are some circumstances. You're laid up because of illness. severe illness. You can't even move. Those things are understood by God. But God wanted you to be here. And I think that I could just stop right there. Here I am, Lord. I am present. Do what you want to do with me. I don't come here with an agenda of my own. I come here because you are here, because you have never missed a feast. And I want you to use me. I want you to work on me. Like the potter works on the clay. And mold me. And make me after your will. Because my desire is to serve you in spirit and in truth. So why are we here at the Feast of Tabernacles? We are here because the tabernacle is the dwelling place of God. We've come to where he is. And unlike the weekly Sabbath or other feast days where we go to church and we get into the word and we hear all of what is said, this feast differs because living with God is quite different than just a visit. Living and dwelling with God is absolutely the greatest relationship you can have with him. And that is why this feast, it portrays scripturally the coming time when the tabernacle of God will come to the earth, where God will dwell with man. Did you get that? I wonder if you understand that. The creator of the heavens and the earth, the maker of all mankind, it is his plan and his desire to dwell with man, and that man should dwell with him. He wants to restore the original relationship when he created man. And man was living with God in the Garden of Eden. And then that was disrupted by the enemy we are talking about. The enemy came in and disrupted it. But God, who is faithful from everlasting to everlasting, has this plan to restore the dwelling of God and man. And you will see in Exodus chapter 25, verses 8 and 9, where in speaking to Moses, God said to him to say to the Israelites, have them, the Israelites, make a sanctuary for me, and I will dwell among them. Make this tabernacle, if you don't know what that sanctuary is, it's the tabernacle. Make this tabernacle and all its furnishings exactly like the pattern I will show you. There is, right now as we come to the Feast of Tabernacles, there is the authentic, original, divine tabernacle that exists in heaven. This is not a guesswork. This is not a joke. This is not something that we are making some kind of a fairy tale. So God used the tabernacle in heaven and gave Moses the pattern of it and said, build the tabernacle after that pattern. Because what God wanted was to see a reflection of the tabernacle in heaven to be on earth. And he so instructed Moses. That tabernacle was a copy of the tabernacle in heaven. And it represents the dwelling of God on the earth with man. If you go to Psalm 8, 84, Psalm 84, and you begin in verse 1, we go up to verse 7, or maybe not as far, we go up to verse 4. It describes for us how David saw the tabernacle. And I hope each one of us can really get out of ourselves in a sense and to reflect on this expression, these expressions that David made concerning the tabernacle. It says, how lovely is your tabernacle, O Lord of hosts. That's how he saw it. That is why when we come here, all the things that were spoken here from this podium by the leaders concerning how we must conduct ourselves, concerning the way in which we reflect God to others. How lovely is your tabernacle, O God, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, even faints for the courts of the Lord. That's how he felt about going to the Feast of Tabernacles. My soul longs. As the feast was approaching, he just couldn't wait night and day. He dreams about it before it comes. He thinks about it. His heart is totally consumed and his mind with the tabernacle of God. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. David was reflecting and looking at the tabernacle that was standing there and would see how even the birds would be drawn to it and they would find themselves nesting in the tabernacle. Christ would say to us, consider the lilies, consider the birds, how I feed them, how I care for them, much less you and me. When we come into the tabernacle of God, it makes us into far more than just simple human beings with blood, flesh, and bones. It makes us into beings which God has promised in the future to be exactly like his Son, Jesus Christ. Even your altars, O God, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God, blessed are those who dwell in your house. They will still be praising. I thank God for you, because your presence here is a dwelling in God's house. And God has taken note of it. He has taken note of every issue you had to go through in order to be here. He knows it. And he's seen your hearts and your minds. And he has not overlooked it. But notice, after Moses and the Israelites built the tabernacle. What happened? You see this in Exodus 40, verses 34 to 35. It says, the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. What does that mean? The presence of the Lord was there. It filled the tabernacle. Verse 35. Moses could not enter the tent of meeting because the cloud had settled upon it. And the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle as he is here with us. Whether you know it or not, whether you believe it or not, whether you understand it or not, God is present by his Spirit right here in this place. There's a song which says, there's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. And I know it is the Spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face. And I know it is the presence of the Lord. Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet heavenly dove, stay right here with us. Fill us with your love. And for each of these blessings, we lift our hearts in praise. Without a doubt, we know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place. You shall be like Moses when he left the mountain, and when he came back, the people could hardly look at him. When you leave this place, you've been in God's presence, and you are going to reflect that presence to the world. And that is why we rejoice about the coming tabernacle of God to the earth. That is why we come together to celebrate the tabernacle of God. Because in the book of Revelation, in chapter 21, the second to last book, it says, in verses 3 to 4, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. It makes no sense coming to the Feast of Tabernacles and not doing all that is so that we will dwell in the real, the authentic tabernacle. God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, no sorrow, no crying. There shall be no more pain. Former things are passed away. No more coronavirus. And no more of all that nonsense. This is the only place you can come to. And when I say only place, the Church of God across the globe, where you can have the answer, the solution to the problems that mankind faces. The only place. Vaccines may be a temporary stop, but there have been thousands of vaccines that have been created over many decades, and still the problem persists. Whatever solutions man will bring, let him try. Let him do his best. But the ultimate answer to the problems of this globe comes because of the King who dwells with us in the Feast of Tabernacles. And that is why we come to learn about God, to learn more, to learn his ways, to do more of what he wants us to do. And for the rest of this presentation, I'd like to remind us of our own longing, ambition to build that tabernacle, but what God says about that. If you want to use a title for this presentation, you can call it or say, called to be priests, kings and priests. Called to be kings and priests. Because that is what, why you are here and why I'm here. God has promised us something. He has promised us that we will reign with him as kings and priests in his kingdom. But when we are called to be kings and priests, do we really understand what that is all about? Have we sat to contemplate it? What have we done to magnify an understanding of what God is talking about when he says he has called us to be kings and priests? You turn to the 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. And there you see the Apostle Peter, in quoting from Exodus 19 and verse 6, says, "But you are a chosen people." This is very assertive. This is not a question. He's telling it like it is. "You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may," that's a purpose. You know, all these things. Why? "That you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light." What is the significance of being a king and a priest? Is it just a name only? We see kings on the earth. We see priests, people calling themselves priests, in various church congregations. But when this statement was made by Peter, it was quite a rub on his listeners, who were predominantly Jewish. And they know that what is being said here, they would say something is not right. They would say, "No, what? Called to be kings and priests? Come on." And why would they say that? The suggestion that believers were called out from the world to be royal priesthood was in conflict with the law. It was like you're breaking the law. Peter, have you backslidden? When he makes that statement. Because in the law, the kingship and the priesthood are strictly separated. And combining them attracted extreme punishment. They knew this. They knew of the punishment, the way God has punished kings in the past for seeking to do this. I know Peter is coming to say, "You're going to be kings and priests? What's going on here?" Combining them constituted a crime. Priests came from the lineage of Aaron, the tribe of Levi, and kings came from the tribe of Judah, and there was to be no mixing. So this the strict separation of these two offices, the punishment for anyone who tries to combine them is extreme. And it is illustrated in the Bible. It is illustrated for us how God's judgment came upon two kings that attempted to combine the priesthood and the kingship. I want us to understand what's going on here, that this is a very unusual, extreme, radical development in Israel, considering what they have seen and known. Because God punished both Saul and Uzziah for combining the kingship and the priesthood. Turn with me, please, to 1 Samuel chapter 13 and verse 8. We are here to learn to fear the Lord, and we must dig deep into his word. King Saul had to go to war. And before you could go to war, the priest had to offer up sacrifices to God to protect the army of God's people. And Samuel was the priest that should have come. Samuel should have come within 7 days. And while they were there waiting, they couldn't see Samuel. Not only that, the people around who came out for this sacrifice and so on, because, you know, they know that this is a big day, we're sending off the army and so on. When they don't see Samuel, they start scattering and to go home. And so, the king felt a bit of loss of face, a bit of shame. His pride rose up. And so he decided, well, since Samuel hasn't come, and I know that we have to go to war, and since the people are leaving and all that, let me just do a thing. Now read with me. We're going to read from verse 8. Speaking of Saul, and he waited 7 days, the time appointed by Samuel. But Samuel did not come to Gilgal, and the people were scattering from him. So Saul said, bring the burnt offering here to me, and the peace offering. And he offered the burnt offering. Verse 10, as soon as he had finished offering the burnt offering, behold, Samuel turned up. And Saul went out to meet him and greet him. Samuel said to him, what have you done? And Saul said, when I saw that the people were scattering from me and that you did not come within the days appointed, and that the Philistines had mustered at the Mishmash, whatever it is, how you pronounce it, I said, now the Philistines will come down against me. Notice, you know, it's not a bad reasoning, you know. Because the people were there, they were getting restless, they were leaving. The time, the 7 days had just gone. And the enemies were now fully equipped and ready for fight. So he's explaining. And so he says, now the Philistines will come down against me at Gilgal, and I have not sought the favor of the Lord. So I forced myself. He knows he was not to do it. He knows God says don't. But in his wisdom, his rational mind, in trying to solve God's problem, in a manner of which God has forgotten, but I remember. So I forced myself and offered the burnt offering. And Samuel said to Saul, you have done foolishly. You have not kept the command of the Lord your God with which he commanded you. For when the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever, for then the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever. Know that this has happened. Your kingdom shall not continue. He lost it. He lost it because he violated the rule of keeping the priesthood and the kingship separate. It was not authorized. That is why it would puzzle the average Jew to say, what's going on here? I'm not going to fall in that trap, what Peter talking about. Because I see what God did when men tried to bring the priesthood and the kingship together. Read this other one. This is even worse. Worse was the punishment of Uzziah, who broke this rule. You see that in 2 Chronicles chapter 26. It says of Uzziah, he was a very successful, by the way, and he, you know, a lot of achievements, but his success got to his head and he became prideful. And because of that, he felt so great. He thought, I don't need God. God need me. I'm such a good guy. God is looking for people like me. So when I do these things, God will say, okay, man, that is my man. I'll take care of it. I don't have to, you know, I understand this man. He's a very sincere man. So I don't have to worry about whether he loves me. No, not at all. Not at all. The lessons are here for you and for me. Let's read it. 2 Chronicles 26, starting in verse 16. But after Uzziah became powerful, his pride led to his downfall. He was unfaithful to the Lord, his God, and entered the temple of the Lord to burn incense on the altar of incense. Azariah, the priest, this time is another priest. The first priest was Samuel. Now this is another priest. Azariah the priest, with 80 other righteous priests, courageous priests of the Lord, followed him in because it's a king and so on. And they see him going with incense. They want to say, is this man out of his mind? What is he going to do? So they followed him in. They confronted him when they saw what he was about to do. They confronted King Uzziah and said, it is not right for you, Uzziah, to burn incense to the Lord. This is for the priests, the descendants of Aaron, who have been consecrated to burn incense. Leave the sanctuary, for you have been unfaithful, and you will not be honored by the Lord God. They're talking to the king. But there's a time that come that if the king is breaking the law, violating the law, you must not follow the king. It is better to obey God rather than man. And this is where they meet at a junction. Uzziah, who had a censer in his hand, ready to burn incense, became angry. See what I mean? Being corrected, became angry. While he was raging at the priests in their presence before the incense altar in the Lord's temple, leprosy broke out on his forehead. But do you think it's a simple matter we're talking about? This whole thing of kings and priests? Leprosy broke out on his forehead. The first one lost his job as king. This one, he became a leper. When Azariah, the chief priest, and all the other priests looked at him, they saw that he had leprosy on his forehead. So they hurried him out. Indeed, he himself was eager to leave because the Lord had afflicted him. King Uzziah had leprosy until the day he died. He lived in a separate house, leprous and banned from the temple of the Lord. The question here is, what's going on? Why is it that this was the experience? Why is it that God was so strongly opposed to combining the priesthood and the kingship? And now it is being said that you are going to be kings and priests. Were the offices of king separated and pre-separated? The reasons for it is, can we come up with anything from the Bible? Does it tell us why? Because by understanding why it was separated, you may understand it also why you yourself now are being allowed to be kings and priests. Well, from reading the scriptures, what you will discover is that so powerful are these two offices that when combined, it is not fit for a carnal person to fill that office. It tells you something about what God thinks of you. It tells you of your hope. The combined office of kings and priests can only be filled by one who has attained the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Wonderful. Because to be called a king and a priest combined is the ultimate office that man, in fact, Christ himself, could obtain. It's an office that rises way above any conceivable office that you can fill on this globe. President of the United States? Okay. Prime Minister of Britain, or King of Norway, or all of the African nations with the chiefs and all these things? These are people I've seen, by the way, in my job, I see a whole lot of these things because I have to travel to various countries, to meet kings, to meet presidents, to meet prime ministers, and I see the way in which they are on their thrones, above, untouchable. And so, it is interesting that in Zechariah 6, verses 12 to 14, and in Hebrews 7 and verse 3, you are seeing some glimpses of what we are seeing here, that God does not allow this office to be filled by a carnal being. Zechariah 6, verses 12 to 14 says, "Take silver and gold, make an ornate crown, and set it on the head of Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Then say to him," in other words, God is illustrating something here. It's not that Joshua was breaking the law. He is giving an instruction, but he wants to paint a picture in the minds of people as to where the answer to this divided office comes from, how he's going to answer it. "Then say to him, Thus says the Lord of hosts, behold, a man whose name is Branch, capital B, Branch. For he will branch out from where he is, and he will build the temple of the Lord. Yes, it is he who will build the temple of the Lord, and he who will bear the honor, glory, and sit and rule on his throne. Thus, he will be a priest on his throne, and the council of peace, and the council of peace will be between the two offices. The council of peace. In other words, these two offices, for them to reign peacefully together, it has to be done by the divine power of God. It can't be done otherwise. You look in the Epistle of Hebrews, and it says to us here, speaking of Melchizedek and Christ, it says, I didn't put the verse in here, but let me just read it for you. Having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abides a priest continually, made not after the law of a carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life. Because the carnality is the issue why God did not give both the king, both the kingship, and the priesthood to his kings and priests in Israel. So, when Peter makes this statement, we need to understand, oh, so we are getting something that not even God's priests, not even Aaron, not even the kings of the Old Testament had the privilege of holding these two offices. None of them. It goes on. 1 Peter 2, 5 to 9. You also, a living stone, are being built up by a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Christ. But you are a chosen nation, generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Notice it's saying you are. Notice it's not saying just you will be. Notice that this is something that is being offered to the church of God, to the people of God, that they are, in a earthly sense, thanks. They are kings and priests. So we need to examine that. Because are you not carnal? So how is it? How is it then? Is this a double standard that God is carrying out? Or is there more we must understand? We must understand the value of being buried and resurrected with Jesus Christ in baptism. We must understand the radical nature in which we have been changed and in which we differ from the priests and kings of the Old Testament. In Hebrews 10:26 and in Hebrews 10:12 it says, Christ our high priest has made one sacrifice for sin for all time, and there's no more sacrifice, says verse 26, there's no more sacrifice for sin that can be made. So the sacrifice that was made by the priests of the Old Testament, those sacrifices is being carried out in you and me. And I'm taking this a little bit further because we need to understand this is not an easy ride, a joy ride that God has given to us. When we say that we are buried and resurrected with Christ, the biblical understanding of that is that we must literally understand what death means and what this resurrection means and what is really happening to us. That we are going out of existence and coming back into existence, raised with Christ. This is a miraculous performance that Christ has accomplished in our lives that has changed us. I want you to understand that being in the Church of God is not just a wait and see experience. It is an experience of being, B-E-I-N-G, where you are already being what God wants you to be. Some theologians have used the term already not yet, where God sees things as though they are. And you have been made to be kings and priests. But in what sense? How do you fulfill your role as a king and a priest now in this life? How is it done? Well, let's start at the beginning. We know that the role of a king is to reign and to rule. So we understand what kings must do. They reign and they rule with authority. And we know that the role of a priest is to offer sacrifices to make intercession because they have access to God. Access to God, by the way, is not something that everyone has. I want us, without being unkind in any way, to people who are in churches and various other whatever. God bless them. Christ made them. Christ died for them. There's a hope for them. Don't bother about that. But understand what God is doing and what he's saying. The only people on the earth who have access to the throne of God are those he has called to be kings and priests, and they have a duty in the earth to continue to intercede on behalf of this earth, on behalf of everybody else. But those others do not have that access. That's an access that the people of God, you who are here at the Feast of Tabernacles and have been baptized, that access is exclusive. In fact, in John 9 and verse 31, and there are many other scriptures you can read, and we can always have a discussion about this at some other time. John 9, 31, it reads, "We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to the one who worship him and does his will. Everyone who has not come to know what sin is, to repent of it, to be baptized, and to begin to obey the law of God. Because a sin is a transgression of the law of God. As long as you have not gone through that process, that is what you are called, sinner. You don't have access. A lot of people try to pray, a lot of people, oh God. Go ahead. But understand. Understand. Satan has so designed things that he makes everybody feel that they have access to the throne of God. But the only way you have access to the throne of God is through Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ says, no one comes to me except the Father who has sent me draws him. Clear words. You need no dictionary to define that for you. So unless you are called, you do not have access to Christ, through whom you have access to God, his Father. What we are saying here is that there is an exceptional privilege that you have. I'm glad we have got here together at the Feast of Tabernacles as God's people, because we need to come together to remind ourselves of who we are and what God expects of us. We need to do that. It is an exceptional privilege that you have access to God. Therefore, do not treat that privilege lightly. Understand the purpose of this privilege. It is not for yourself only. It is because you are the priests of God in the earth, and you are the ones to whom God listens on behalf of the rest of mankind, in as much as the priests in Israel, the people could not bring the sacrifice directly by themselves. They could not. They had to go to the priest, and the priest would offer the sacrifice on their behalf. You are that priest in today's world. And therefore, we are intercessors in the earth for Jesus Christ to reach to God on behalf of the people of the world. So every person who is a member of the Church of God, a baptized member who has been called, who has come to know what sin is, what repentance is, what obedience is, who has died and is resurrected with Christ in baptism, and on whom the laying of hands is taking place for the Spirit of God to be in you. You are a priest of God in the earth. That is why you see in Zechariah, look at this, Zechariah 8, verse 23, which shows it in another way. It says, thus saith the Lord of hosts, in those days it shall come to pass that 10 men out of all languages, that is talking the nations, out of all the languages of the nations, shall take hold of the hem of a Jew, saying, we will go with you. Notice, we can't go ourselves. We don't have access. We can't go ourselves. We will go with you. Why? For we have heard that God is with you. That is why. That is how you get to come to God. Can't go to God just like that. You don't have access. Access is a big thing. So the question is, if we are priests, how do we offer sacrifices? We know that Christ is a once and for all sacrifice. We know that we do not use blood of goats and bulls. We know that the blood of Jesus Christ reigns forever. But what we need to remember is that we are called to die with him, to suffer with him, to take up this cross. Except a man can take up his cross and follow me, he cannot be my disciple. The cross that Christ carried, you and I, like him, because we are like him in the world, we are carrying a cross, not by way of the shedding of our blood, or blood is not necessary. The blood of Jesus Christ is what serves that purpose. But look at what it is saying here in Hebrews 13:15. Through him, that's Jesus, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of lips that give thanks to his name, and do not neglect doing good and sharing, for with such sacrifices God is pleased. So we all know about we give sacrifice of praise, but what does that mean? What does it mean, sacrifice of praise? Because many people understand praise to be, you know, you give glory to God and you give thanks to God and all kinds of things, but people do that generally when lots of good things are happening and they are able to give up joy and give up a lot of praise to God. So praise is often seen as a response to benefits that we receive. That's how most people see praise. And so we find it easy to praise God from that motivation. When God blesses us, we praise him and we say good things and we're wonderful and we read Psalms and all that kind of thing. But that kind of praise, although worthwhile, does not fit the description of sacrifices of praise. You can have praise. You have sacrifice. When you have sacrifices of praise, it's a different thing. We need to understand that. Sacrifices of praise is praise that goes up to God when we are suffering at the deepest level. That is sacrifice of praise. The medical test comes back positive. You give God thanks, you give him glory. Because God knows why. God knows why. And you lift up his name and you give joy. And you don't go around moping and complaining and grousing. You give God sacrifice and praise together. Your spouse who wants a divorce, it comes that way. You do everything to stop it. But if it is going to happen, which it ought not to, you do not now drop your hand and say, look like God, forget me. You do not behave in ways. You give sacrifices of praise to God for whatever you're going through. Your child is wayward and you can't control, and you find that it is more than you can manage. You give sacrifices of praise, because the more you feel pain and the deeper the sacrifice, the greater the praise that we give to God. The landlord throw you out of the house, or the mortgage company close in on you. The thing to do is to get on your knees and give sacrifice of praise. Let me tell the difference between them. It is not that you go to God and say, Lord, I don't know what is going on with me. I don't know why they're doing this to me. But they're asking you, oh God, to deal with the one that is the... What you need to do is to say, Lord, you have told me that you'll never leave me nor forsake me. That the Lord directs the path of those who trust in him. And I know that you have your purpose in this matter. And I come to you, Almighty God, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and I ask you to accomplish in me your will and the things that you are seeking to do. Because God wants us to come to a point where our faith can be tested and he can know that we are genuine and we are true. It's one thing, well, praise God because he allows you now to be able to buy a house, and praise him because you get a good job, and praise him because your child got the highest grade in school, and you keep praising him for those things. Anybody can do that. Anybody can do that. That is not what he calls sacrifice of praise. That is why you and I go through sacrifices. That is why you and I go through hard times. That is why challenges come upon us. Because we are priests. And we must have the opportunity to give sacrifices of praise unto God. That is what God means. But to praise God in those times, it is hard. It is difficult. I'm telling you, I know it. It is hard. Because even though you know these things, your feelings cannot give you. There's no, you feel like you're talking foolishness. When you go and say, Lord, thank you. Thank you for what? It really, really is a challenging thing. It really, really is a hard thing. But it was a challenging thing and a hard thing for Jesus to be nailed on a cross. And we must be like him. Till we come to the fullness of the stature of Jesus Christ is what we seek to do as God's people. That is where it is. That's where the difference is. So, our praise is not to be based on our opinion of God's job performance, whether he's doing well, and therefore we praise him. No, we are not examining God. We must praise God because genuinely, deeply down, we understand what it is to be a king and a priest. Psalm 51 expresses this idea when it says, you do not delight in sacrifice, or I will bring it to you. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, that God will not despise. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. There's another spiritual sacrifice. It's a sacrifice of the temple, the body. Therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. The sacrifice that you have to make in order to give up the idolatry, the fornication, the uncleanness, the lasciviousness, the witchcraft, the hatred, the wrath, the strife, the seditions and the heresies, the envyings, the murders, the drunkenness, the reveling, and all these things, that is a big part of the sacrifice that has to be given up. All these things is part of your duty as a priest. So when these things happen, don't see yourself as just ordinary and you're going through these things and so on. See it as, I am a priest, and God gives me that to do. But we are kings. We're not only priests, we are kings. And that's where I'm closing in this part. So what should we do as kings? As we said, kings are persons who govern, they rule with authority. So in what sense does God want us to be a king at this time? Well, Jesus gave a parable in which he spoke, it's in Matthew 25, in which he spoke about a nobleman who went to receive a kingdom. And in going, he called his servants and he gave them so many talents. And he says, take care of these until I come. And when he returned, he saw how some did well, some did not do well. The things he gave them to do were manageable things. And at the end, when he came, he says, you do well, take this. Govern over 10 cities, you become a king. Take this, govern over 5 cities, and so on. So he shows, in that sense, how the idea of king in the future, how you attain that kingship now. So, what is it that you're expected to do as a king? As a king, you are a ruler. What is that rulership for? Proverbs 16:32 says, he who rules his spirit is greater than he who takes a city. The relationship between the rulership of our spirit and gaining a city to rule over is somewhat paralleled here. And so, the rulership that God wants us to have is to develop an attitude not just of merely, dealing with the issues of our personal, mind and body and spirit, not in a very casual way, but to become rulers, to be commanders, to be in charge of, to subject our bodies to the law of God. Subject it. The people under rulers are called subjects. And you need your body to become a subject to you, because you're a ruler. And all the various things that you're supposed to do, that God asks us to do, we bring everything into subjection. All the strongholds and all the things, we bring them under subjection, into obedience to Jesus Christ. So we are kings. We break down strongholds and we bring everything that stands against Christ into subjection to him. That's the work of a king. That's the kingship we carry through now. And this kingship is like the talents that God has given that we must accomplish in order to rule over cities. Luke 16, verse 10. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is also unjust in much. So God is seeing us in our kingly role now in the earth to rule over ourselves, rule over our minds, rule over our bodies, rule over our behaviors, and rule over those who promote false doctrines against God. God wants to know if we are trustworthy in little things before he entrusts us with big things. So, we must learn to rule now, and we must learn to offer sacrifices now. And that is, as a king and a priest, you will reign with Christ in the kingdom because God has promised it Revelation 20 and verse 6, as we come to a close, it says, blessed and holy are those who have part in the first resurrection. The only people who comes up in the first resurrection are those who are first fruits, those who belong to God's people, who observe all these feasts which we do throughout the year. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God and of Christ, and will reign, that's kingship, with him for 1,000 years. To him who overcomes and does my will to the end, I will give authority over the nations. So brethren, welcome to the Feast of Tabernacles. This is your dwelling place, because you are a child of God. You belong to God. Let us enjoy being here. Let us understand the purpose. Let us reflect the attitudes and the behaviors that Christ has called us to demonstrate to the world. Let us use this Feast of Tabernacles to strengthen ourselves in a manner that will cause us to better represent Christ to others when we leave. We know that God is not trying to save the whole world now. We know that. But we are the only body that has an answer to that issue. Isaiah 2, verses 2 to 4, says, in the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as chief among the mountains. That is, the governments. God's government will be chief among the governments. It will be raised above the hills, that is, authorities. It will raise above all authorities, and all nations will stream to it. That is what is going to happen in the future. Many peoples will come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways, so that we may walk in his paths. Let us therefore know that this is speaking about you, is speaking about me. Whatever it is that we are going through, we are experiencing, whatever it is that people say we are this or we are that, whatever they want to class us as, just make sure that you are faithful to the end, because this is already prepared and waiting, and Christ has promised it. I will take my rewards with me, and you and I, thanks be to God, will be members of the government of God, rulers and priests in his kingdom. May God bless you. May he help us to be faithful to the end. Amen.
Thank you very much, Pastor Ramakan, for sharing that great message on this first day of the Feast of Tabernacles. Truly a fitting message to kick off this feast. As I said, great anticipation for this feast. So thank you very much. Let's give him another round of applause. Great way to start the feast. Minus of our current position and future goal as kings and priests to come in the kingdom of God. But just to remind you, brethren, that we are collecting an offering today. You should have envelopes on your seat. If you don't have an envelope, raise your hand and one of the deacons will get an envelope to you. And I'll ask those who are so designated to collect the offerings to take up their positions. We will sing a song to prepare us, number 232 from our red hymnal, 232. We plow the fields and scatter
the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. He sends the snow and winter, the warm to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine and soft, refreshing rain.
Soft, refreshing rain. All the gifts around us are sent from heaven above. Then thank the Lord, oh, thank the Lord for all his love. He only is the maker of all things near and far. He paints the wayside blood. It's the evening star. The winds and waves obey him. By him the birds are fed. Much more to us his children he gives our daily bread. All the gifts around us are sent from heaven above. Then thank the Lord, oh, thank the Lord for all his love. Set the gifts we offer, for all thy love imparts, and what thou most desirest are humble and thankful hearts. All the gifts around us are sent from heaven above. Then thank the Lord, who thank the Lord for all his love.
Amen. We will close with the singing of number 24 from the Red Hymnal. Number 24 from the Red Hymnal, while the offering is being collected. And after the singing of this hymn, I'll invite Deacon Winston Samuels from our Maroon Town congregation to come with the closing prayer and the blessing of the offering and the meal. So I invite Deacon Samuels to come with the closing prayer after we sing number 24 from the Red Hymnal while the offering is being collected. Love divine, or love excelling, joy of heaven to earth come down, fixing us thy humble dwelling, all thy faithful mercies crown.
Faith has its peace. mighty to deliver, let us all thy life receive. Suddenly return and never, never more thy temples leave. Thee we would be always blessed, serve thee as thy host above. Pray and praise thee without ceasing, glory in thy perfect love. Finish then thy new creation, pure and spotless let us be. Let us see thy great salvation, perfectly restored in thee be. Change from glory into glory, till with thee we take our place, till we cast our crowns before thee, lost in wonder, love, and praise.
Hallelujah! You may stand for the closing prayer.
Shall we pray? Great God and Father, which art in heaven, holy is your name. You are God, and beside you there is none else. We thank you, Father, for your goodness towards us, your children. We thank you for this grand opportunity to come in your house of praise, this, the very first day of Tabernacles. We thank you, Lord, for the many blessings that you have bestowed upon us. You have made it possible, Lord, that we could come to sing praises, to dance before your presence, Lord God. You have made it possible. We thank you for the manservant, Father, whom you have provided today to share with us this wonderful information of us coming to know who we are, what we are about, and what we shall become. We pray, God, that we reflect on every word. Take the word seriously. Kings and priests elect we are, Father, and we are now in training for the great world tomorrow. Great God and Father, we thank you for those of us who have made the sacrifices to be here. It's not easy for many of us, but we are here to rejoice. We're here knowing that, God, that after all of this, despite the pandemic, despite all the things that are happening in the world tomorrow, all of these things will be a thing of the past. So we pray today, Father, that we humble ourselves and we wait on you and be of good courage. Strengthen our fainting heart, Father. Give us the mind to continue despite all that we are faced with, Father. We know this life is not all about it. We know there's better ahead of us. And so we await, mighty God, the blessings that you have in store for us of being changed to become like you. We ask, oh God, that you will direct our path. Help us to be faithful in all things. We ask, Lord God, that you will wash us thoroughly, purify our hearts and our mind, great God, and give us the kind of mind to continue despite the challenges, oh God. We pray, Lord God, for your peace to be upon us and your love that casts all fears. Father, I pray that you will breathe upon the offering that your people have stretched to you, that the work will continue far and wide. Lord, lead for us, I pray, oh God. And let us follow faithfully. We tell our thanks through the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
You may be seated. Time is well spent. Welcome, Ambassador, please. In fact, we don't have any announcements, so we'll have the welcome Ambassador at this time, and then we will close.
Joy from joy far, we are You're welcome now. Go there with the pian pian clapping later. Come. Let's go. Where's the bag? Obliging, no seminar of the daddy business, right? Today is a double Sabbath. So it's double the joy, double the praise, double the worship. It's the Feast of Tabernacles and it's the seventh day Sabbath. So you should be double happy. In the midst of Corona, I see people from all over. Right? We have people from Orchard Hills? Do we? Just give me a wave. All the Orchard people in, give me a wave. Welcome. Do we have people from our own town? What about Spanish Town? Just give a, where are the Spanish Town people? Okay, welcome. I hear we have people from Maypen. Is that true? Oh, welcome Maypen. What about What about Canada? I used to almost say Clarendon. What about Canada? Anybody from Canada this year? Yeah, oh my God. I see a little hand go up. Well, welcome. What about the U.S.? USA! Woo! Yeah. Oh. Several hands. 1 year from UCG USA, right? Welcome to the feast. Is this the first time you're feasting with us? First time here in Jamdog. No. Did I miss anybody? Where? You know I have it right here. UK! Welcome! No, other team never forget. Did I miss anybody before we move on to this one? King? I don't think so. Yeah, do we have anybody from Kingston? Welcome. I also hear we have some newbies to the feast, some first timers in the form of new people and new babies. This is their very first feast, so let's get ready to really, really welcome them. Newbies, where are you? And the babies, you can't put up them hand, the parents, they need to help them. Come, where are the newbies? I see one there, welcome. That's a baby, right? Yes, I see, welcome. At the back, welcome. I think Kenny and two children, they are newbies. This is their first piece? First, yes, welcome. I hear Ray have a newbie too. Welcome. Which other newbie in the house? Your sister! Welcome! Where are the other newbies? Newbies, it's your time to shine. Come on, we're getting once, twice, three times. Go on, we're going to invite you to come to the welcome desk because let's see who we have there. We have Chris, a whole lot of them. Delores, Debbie, Ali, Mary, at the welcome desk, and we stand ready to serve you. And we also have literature. Don't forget the real reason of the welcome desk. The literature, and the sanitizer, and the mask, and the programs, and the feast calendars, the real reason. So do come by and pick up something, right? But today's message, it's really something. because it reminds us that when we're at our lowest, our sacrifice is the greatest. And this is a testament, you feast-keeping people on a dire. You know, this is a time here on a dire. So it's a testament because we have work to do. We have a mission. I'll never go out and make this a testimony, because what's your mission? What is your mission? What's your mission? Go out and show the people and say, on a no how to testify.
Speaking of evangelism, tomorrow is our evangelism outreach. Now, of course, we have restrictions in terms of physical numbers and space, etc. But we do have technology to help us. Therefore, this is where each and every one of you come in to play. The topic is the Feast of Tabernacles for Christians? A look at Jesus' shocking comments concerning the Feast of Tabernacles. So that is the Feast of Tabernacles for Christians? A look at Jesus' shocking comments concerning the Feast of Tabernacles. Now, you have no limits as to how many persons you can invite online. So invite them to subscribe to the channel. Let them know that this presentation is coming up, the Feast of Tabernacles, whether it is for Christians, so that they can hear and they can listen and hear from the Word of God and hear Jesus' own shocking comments concerning the Feast of Tabernacles. I believe the message will start at about 12 noon. So you can invite them to come onto the channel at 12 noon. You can send them the link at 11 once it starts, and invite them to come at 12 noon to listen to the live evangelistic outreach presentation. Let me take the opportunity as well to commend you for your diligence, for your discipline. As so far, we have not had any incidents. The hotel is under strict monitoring as it relates to the observance of the protocols, right? And we are meeting here under the condition that we adhere to those protocols. And so far, you have done very well, very well. And yes, you can give a round of applause. You deserve it. And let us keep doing so, okay? So just to remind us once more that if you're not staying at the Grand Baha'i, you shouldn't be loitering around other areas of the premises, right? When you're leaving, please, the way that you would have entered when you were directed this morning, please use that same direction, that same path. I believe it's to the left and down some stairs where you would have came, the same direction it came this morning when you were directed. That is the way that you are to leave as well. All right, the time is well spent. We resume at 4 p.m. We do have two services. We resume at 4 p.m., so get some refreshments and be back on time, as we will have an afternoon service. But I'll dismiss this service with a reading from the Word of God, so I'll invite us to stand for the closing reading, which is taken from the book of Revelation, chapter 1, and it reads, "Grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the peoples of this earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Shalom. Resume at 4 p.m.